Hello, welcome back. We saw in our last lecture that Newton-Raphson method is one of the best fixed point iteration methods. It's a very fast convergent method which gives a sequence which converges very fast to the root. But we also noticed that there was an extra problem with this method. And what we would like to do now is to introduce a small change in that method so that that extra problem of the computation of the derivative is taken care of. Okay, so let's recall a Newton-Raphson method for us. Whenever you have a twice differentiable function, then the Newton-Raphson fixed point iteration method is this method is to finding a root of f. This is given by some initial approximation p naught. And then the successive approximations are given by this formula. So P1 will be P naught minus F P naught upon F prime P naught. P2 will be P1 minus F P1 upon F prime P1, and so on. So at each step, we have to compute two values. We have to compute the value of the function F at Pn minus 1. And we also need to compute the value of the derivative f prime at p n minus 1. These two computations are needed, and whether you believe it or not, the computation of the derivative is typically more difficult than the computation of the function value. Forget about polynomials. For polynomials, it does happen that the derivative is a polynomial of smaller degree. And therefore, you may need smaller number of calculations. But when you have other functions involved, you might just think about x square e power x cube, for instance, and then compute the derivative, which will be a sum of some similar looking functions. So therefore, the computation of derivatives is typically far more difficult than computation of the function values themselves. So we introduce a slight variation to circumvent this problem, and it's a very nice trick. The point it's called second method. So the point is, whenever you have a function which is differentiable at a point, then the derivative is the ratio of the change in function values to the change in the parameters. So it is the limit x going to 0 of fa minus fx upon a minus x. This is the derivative at the point a. Now we have already made one assumption for Newton-Raphson method, which is that our p naught is very close to p. Our initial approximation is close to p. That was our assumption, and therefore we could drop that degree 2 term. Here we make one more similar assumption, which is that when we take these approximations, then the next approximation is very close to the previous approximation. So we assume that p n minus 2 is close enough to p n minus 1 so that the derivative at p n minus 1 is simply the ratio which is from p n minus 1 to p n minus 2. So by looking at the definition of the derivative above, we have that it is f of p n minus 1 minus f of p n minus 2 upon p n minus 1 minus p n minus 1. So we will replace the derivative value of p f at p n minus 1 by this ratio. Okay, and therefore, using this approximation to the derivative, our Newton-Raphson method will give, it's a new formula that you have, which is that p n is p n minus 1. Remember, the Newton-Raphson said that you have to subtract the ratio of the function value at p n minus 1 upon the derivative at p n minus 1. So the derivative is already a ratio now. And therefore, the numerator of the derivative will go in the denominator of our formula, which is f of p n minus 1 minus f of p n minus 2. And then the denominator of the derivative will come to the numerator of the formula, which is p n minus 1 minus p n minus 1. So this is the new method that we have. This is called the second method. This is because the geometric interpretation will involve drawing secants to the graph of the functions. So the geometric interpretation is as follows. We will need to start with two initial approximations. This is one small drawback compared to the Newton-Raphson, where you have to start only with the first initial approximation. Here we have to have two initial approximations, P0 and P1. Then for P0, we take the point on the graph, which is P0, f of P0. And then for P1, we take the point on the graph, which is P1, f of P1. So these are the two points on the graph. You join them by a straight line. And then extend this straight line so that it intersects the x-axis. Once it intersects, that point is called P2. So by our earlier formula, whatever we have obtained, that you can check is indeed the x-intercept of this line joining the graph points corresponding to P0 and P1. Once you have found this P2, now what you do is that you look at P1, FP1, P2, FP2, join these two points on the graph that intersects the x-axis somewhere, call that point as P3, and so on. So this is the drawing seconds on the graph points. So you have two points on the graph and you join them by a line, intersect with that line with the x-axis, and that is your next approximation. Now, once you have computed P2, at every step, you have to just compute one more function value, which is the function value at the previous approximation. Everything else is already computed for you. So the number of operations is reduced greatly in this method. Whereas in each step of Newton-Raphson method, we will need to compute two things, the function value and the derivative value. Both are needed to be computed. Okay, so geometric interpretation of the second method is as follows. Here we have P0, this point below here, below the x-axis, that is P0, FP0. And P1, FP1 is here above the x-axis. You join them by a line and you intersect. The x-intercept gives you the point P2. Once again, the point P2, FP2 is below the x-axis. And now you join P1 and P2. Intersect it with x-axis, that gives you P3. Okay, so once again, the value for P3 is below the x-axis, but P2 and P3 are here and you join those. So P2, FP2, P3, FP3. These are now joined and we get a point P4 whose corresponding point on the graph is now going to be above the x-axis. So this is how we are approximating the zero that we are looking for. Okay, so this is the second method. We have earlier looked at this function x, cos x minus x, and now we are going to use second method to find the solution to this x equal to cos x, or looking at 0 for cos x minus x, and then we will compare the approximations with the approximations in the Newton-Raphson method. Okay, but we have to start with two initial approximations. If you remember the graph of y equal to cos x and y equal to x, you remember that somewhere near pi by 4, that's where our root was. And above pi by 4, somewhere ahead of pi by 4 was the point x equal to 1. So we consider x equal to 0.5 as our initial approximation. So 0.5, that's our initial approximation. And P1, which is pi by 4, this is our second initial approximation. So P0 and P1, these are the two approximations that we start with. And we have to now write down the formula carefully. It's not as easy as the Newton-Raphson method formula is. Here we have this Pn minus 1 minus Pn minus 2. Remember, this comes from the denominator of the derivative approximation. Okay, the denominator here comes from the numerator of the derivative approximation, which is the cos x minus x. That function evaluated on Pn minus 1. Minus the same function evaluated on Pn minus 2. And the remaining bracket that we have here in the numerator, this corresponds to the function value at Pn minus 1. Remember, the formula is Pn minus 1 minus ratio of f of Pn minus 1, Pn minus 1 minus Pn minus 2 upon f of Pn minus 1 minus f of Pn minus 2. All right, so this is the formula, and we write the results in the following table. So this is the table that the left hand side table from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, that is our good old Newton-Raphson method. This is something that we have already done. We started with pi by 4 as our zeroth approximation and then obtained the other approximations. Whereas here 0 and 1, these are the initial approximations that we have taken for the second method. And then we have to go up to fifth level to get the same value as the Newton-Raphson method, which had obtained that value only at the third level. But if we look at the computations that had taken place, when you go in the Newton-Raphson from the zeroth place to the first place, you will need to compute the derivative as well as the function value on p naught. So those are two computations to go from 0 to 1. To go from 1 to 2, you need two more. So total four computations. And then you go from 2 to 3 and you get two more. So there are six computations which are needed to do, six calculations are needed to do to get the correct result in the Newton-Raphson method, which is obtained at the third place itself. On the other hand, the second method, when you are looking at P0 and P1 and you go to P2, but for P going to P2, you have to do the function value at P0 and the function value at P1. So there are two computations needed to reach P2. To reach the third approximation P3, you will need to compute the function value at P2 also. Then you are going to reach the fourth approximation, for which you will need to compute P3. And finally, when you want to reach the fifth place, you will need to compute the function value at P4. So Newton-Raphson method needed six computations, whereas the second method has needed only five computations. So although the result was neck to neck, when you have to have longer calculations, then second method will win hands down, because at each step you have to do only one calculation. Whereas for the Newton-Raphson method, you have to do two calculations at every step. Okay, so this is how the second method and the Newton-Raphson method compare with each other. There is one more method which has been there since quite long time. In some of the old papyruses and so on, the mention of this method is found. This is the method of false position. So what happens is that in the Newton-Raphson method or the second method, the successive approximations, they may not be on two sides of the root. That means when you compute the function values and take the product, that product may not be negative. It may happen that both f of pn minus 1 and f of pn are on the positive side. They will give you a better approximation perhaps, because the formula is good. But sometimes you may wonder whether the next approximation will also be on the positive side. And some people may think, of course, this is what people in the old days thought, that it's always better to have the successive approximations on two sides of the root. Okay. So then if your product is not negative, then the root may not be between them. Okay. And we will modify this by just taking the pair of approximations which are on both sides of the root. And this is what gives the regular Falsi method. This is called regular Falsi method or the method of false position, because in the initial days, in the very old days, people knew they were going to take some false answers. So you would take two answers, assume that they are answers, but you would know that they are false answers. Therefore, it's called method of false position. And then you join them by seconds and then start taking further approximations. That is what they had. This is the most basic geometric method that one can think about. So here is how this method is applied. We again start with two initial approximations, but we make sure that both of them are on the two sides of the root. As for cos x minus x, we have, if you remember the graph of y equal to cos x and graph of y equal to x, you will see that 0.5 was slightly below the root and pi by 4 is slightly above the root. So 0.5 and pi by 4 contain the root between them. The product of their function values is negative. So this is what we will do. We choose initial approximations p0 and p1. making sure that they are on two sides of the roots by making sure that the product of the function values is negative, then choose the approximation P2 in the same manner as in the second method. It's the x-intercept of the line joining P0 at P0 and P1 at P1. Okay, once this is done, now compute the function value at P0. This is something that we have to anyway do. Compute that value and check whether FP2 into FP1 is negative. If this is negative, then P1 and P2 are on two sides of the root. Then you continue the method as if you were using the second method. So you will apply the second method to the pair P1 and P2. But if not, so we started with FP0 into FP1 negative. So the signs of FP0 and FP1 are distinct. If your FP2, FP1 is not negative, and we will also assume that FP2 is not zero. If it is zero, we have no need for any further discussion. Assume that that FP2 is not zero. Then P2 and P1 will have the same signs of functions. And therefore, instead of P1 and P2, we should look at P0 and P2. So this product will then be negative. And then we apply the second method, not to P1 and P2, but to P0 and P2. Okay, so that at each stitch, the root is safely enclosed between the two successive approximations. This is what we do. So this will ensure that the root that you are looking for is safely ensconced between the two successive approximations. So regular fallacy method is given here for the same function that we had, the cos x. Oh, okay, sorry. This is just some illustration for the same function. Here we had P0, FP0, where the value is negative. P1, FP1, the value is positive. Okay, so P0 and P1 are on two distinct sides of the root. We compute P2 for which the value is negative. So we will look at P1 and P2, just as in the second method. And then we obtained P3, whose value is also negative. So if you remember, for the second method, we had looked at P2, P3 as our next approximation for the next approximation. And we do the second for these two points on the graph. But for the regular falsi, we'll look at P1 and P3 and then draw this line. So we see that this point P4 is between P1 and P3. Whereas here, the point P4 was not between P2, P3. And so you have no control on the point P4 where it goes. So once you have taken these two points, which are on the two sides of the root, it ensures that the next approximation is between those two points. And therefore, you are definitely going to get better and better approximations. Okay. But how far are they? How good are they? That is something that we need to see. So let's look at this earlier example once again. Fx, which is cos x minus x. And we try to illustrate the regular fallacy method by this for this function. So we are going to use the same initial approximations, P0, which is 1 by 2, and P1, which is pi by 4. We will see that this added requirement that the regular fallacy method should have, which is that the root has to be contained in both of these points, may not always give good results. Because the second method is almost as good as the Newton-Raphson method. And therefore, its convergence will be faster. Whereas when you are computing this P4 using P1 and P3 instead of P2 and P3, you may get a wrong answer. Although the point P4 will be between P1 and P3, but it may not be as good to the as closer to the root as the P2, P3 approximation for P4 would have been. Okay, so just as the simplification in the second method from Newton-Raphson did result in some extra steps. Similarly, this added requirement in the second method to get the regular fallacy method does make it slightly worse. And the results are here. the regular falsi, the first column that we see is for the regular falsi, the middle one is for the second, and the last one is of course for our favorite Newton-Raphson method. So we see that we have to go up to the sixth approximation to get the correct answer using the regular falsi method. Second method that way is much better. So if you can, if your function is not very complicated, it's always good to stick to the Newton-Raphson method. But in any case, whether the function is complicated or not, the second method is perhaps the most popular method that one should use, because it does not involve too many computations, and yet it gives the approximation as good as the Newton-Raphson method. So we have learnt four methods to finding roots of functions. There was the bisection method, and then there are these Newton-Raphson method, second method, and the regular falsi method. Okay, and let's do a comparison for that, because we will be moving on to the next topics in the next lecture. So the bisection method, it will guarantee that the sequence converges to the root, because every time you are putting the root between the two approximations that you are getting, and so the root is between it, root is bracketed between the approximations, and therefore the sequence will converge to the root, but it's a very slow method. On the other hand, the other methods are definitely going to work, and even faster, but the convergence is not guaranteed. Once the sequence is convergent, the fixed point iteration methods will give you slightly better results than the bisection method, and Newton-Raphson will of course give you much better result. But the whether the sequence is convergent or not will depend on the initial approximations being very close to the root. You remember that for Newton-Raphson method, we have a theoretical result which guarantees that the roots will go, the approximations will go to the root. But for that, the initial approximation has to be within a certain range, which is not guaranteed, because that delta is not computable. The delta can be computed only once you know the derivative value at the point P, and then you have to take that particular approximation, the particular interval. All right. So even that is not known. So what people then do is the following thing, that it's a normal practice that you first use the bisection method first. You get some points where the function values are of different signs. Use bisection method so that you are close enough to the root, and then use either the Newton-Raphson method or the second method. So this is what people do, and this is where we come to the end of the root finding problem of the equations in one variable. We will perhaps continue with one more lecture on the same theme of equations in one variable, and then we will move to the next thing. So long for this lecture. I will see you in our next lecture. Thank you.